Hello and welcome to the Corner 3. We're posted up and spotted up at Studio 41 presented by Chime, talking all things Dallas Mavericks basketball on and off the floor. My name is Bobby Krell. I'm the digital content manager here for the Mavs. Joining me, two-hatted figures. All right. First, similar fuel, but from a different place. Austyn, Ivan, you're really gearing up for the playoffs now that you're going into sicko mode here with the coffee.
I had to get the coffee this morning, you know, switched it up from my normal, typical Lala run, but we're feeling good with the moon milk.
Mm.
Do you like moon milk?
I love moon milk. I love moon milk so much.
Have you asked if you could, like, buy a gallon of moon milk?
You can. Sell it.
Do you do that?
No.
Oh.
I've only been, like, twice. I don't want to play it up too much.
Okay.
But I can't. You can purchase some, yeah, and I might.
I'll get that for you. End of the season gift. Oh.
Why wait till the end of the season? I'm going to have to stay up till like midnight watching these playoff games next week. Let's get it going.
You need the moon milk.
Yeah. All right. The other guy with the true Brivend hat, Isaac Harris. Isaac, collect yourself. What's up?
Y'all described the moon milk as fluffy.
I didn't.
Creamy, fluffy.
I just don't know how milk can be fluffy.
You haven't had moon milk.
Yeah, sounds like a guy that's never had moon milk.
Is this something that came after the eclipse?
No.
Okay.
Been around. Well, I mean, I guess the first eclipse happened long before moon milk.
What
was
if you
created,
drank it? What if you drank this moon milk during the eclipse?
Oh, that would have been.
You would elevate.
Yeah.
You would transcend.
All right.
Did you watch?
You would understand a whole lot more tweets.
I did watch the eclipse. You know, it's like, all right, that's cool that it happened.
That was it?
I mean, it was cool. Like, I thought it was cool. I think it's a little overrated, but...
Dude, I thought it was awesome. Did you think it was cool?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
All right. Can you...
It was cool.
Skedaddle?
I talked about this on Mavs Land on Monday. It's like, hey, cool. If it's a once-in-a-lifetime thing, we're not getting this hyped over Malachi Flynn's 50-point game. But...
I mean, Tony Delk retired so Malachi Flynn could thrive.
Exactly. And then Malachi Flynn missed, like, every shot he took for, like, three games.
It's okay. He scored 50. Who cares? Dude, who cares? He might score 50 again tonight. It's Mavs versus Pistons here tonight. Now, we're not going to be really getting you ready for Mavs versus Pistons. We're going to be getting you ready for Mavs versus Clippers because, hey, the Mavs got one of these next to their name. In fact, they actually have a Y next to their name on ESPN because they clinched that division, baby.
Whoa.
Wow.
Whoa.
Wow.
They secured the spot.
Oh, that's right. My bad.
They secured.
Can we go back and
guaranteed their spot in the playoffs?
Yeah, that's right. They have locked up the thing. They've guaranteed themselves the deal.
They've claimed it.
Yep, they have planted their flag on that thing.
Keep going.
I need to make sure, okay, there's no cameras in here. There's no microphones in here. Wait a minute. Oh, God. It was nice knowing y'all.
I know.
You might have to carry the show from here. So, the Mavs just wrapped up. Again, you know, this game against the Pistons tonight, so Kyrie's out, Lively's out. Luka's questionable. I believe everybody else is going to play, but... You know, this game against the Pistons and Sunday's game against the Thunder are pretty inconsequential as it relates to the Mavs playoff push. There's a very, very small chance that Dallas could climb up to fourth, but realistically speaking, we're looking at a Clippers at four, Mavs at five playoff series. Next week's show, we will be doing a full super ultra scuba length deep dive into that series, getting you ready for game one, which will be either Saturday or Sunday. The playoff schedule has not come out yet, but it will very soon. But for this show, we're going to take a little bit look back at some of the recent things and then also kind of do like a full season recap because once the playoffs start, we're all in on postseason basketball, baby. There's no more looking back. So that's what we're going to do today.
All right? Some would say all for one.
One for all. One for Dallas.
Dang it.
Dude doesn't even get your mottos
right. I tried. I feel like, has it been that for 3 years?
No, it's Dallas in for a while.
Dallas. Okay, Dallas.
You remember that?
No.
Dallas in, where like we make the A, the L, and the L capitalized?
Mm-mm. No, I don't remember that.
We got two motto non-appreciators up here.
Yeah.
Holy smokes. That's We've got to cool. get it together, y'all.
Okay.
We've got to get it together.
One for all.
One for Dallas.
One for all.
One for Dallas. All right. So recently, the Mavs, they clean swept a 5-game in 7-day stretch. They went 5-0. In 7 days. That started with the homestand last week, wins against the, let me get this order correct. Oh, boy. They beat the Hawks. They beat the Warriors in a back-to-back. They beat the Rockets. Then they went on the road, and they won another back-to-back against Charlotte and Miami. And along the way, they basically ended – well, they literally ended the Rockets season, and they basically forced the Heat into the play-in. So some pretty cold-blooded stuff that we've seen from the Mavs lately. In addition to just racking up a bunch of wins and guaranteeing themselves a spot in the top six. So we had basically been saying for like a month now, this could come down to the last game of the season. Like, nothing might be decided. But now all of a sudden it's only game 81 and the dust is already cleared. Like, here the Mavs are, you know, sitting comfortably ahead of everybody else as they're still scratching and clawing to try and get their way in. So, Isaac, how was Dallas able to do this? How are they able to go 5-0 in 7 days? How are they able to wrap this thing up earlier than expected? And what has this team shown you and proven to you, basically, during the last couple of weeks here?
Yeah, I mean, I've just been so impressed by their I know this is going to sound really cliche or, like, cheesy, but just by their effort. You know, it was one of those games. It was either last week or the week before. They came out in the third quarter. And it's like they just decided at halftime, like, yeah, we're not losing this game. Like, we got this. And it feels like they've been in that mode for every – and they know the stakes. They're playing together. The effort's there. The execution is there. And no matter the opponent, you know, the Golden State game was a great game, you know, on that Friday night.
They all run together. I believe it was a Friday.
Yeah, and then obviously the Houston game was insane, being down by that much, coming all the way back. Exum hitting the shot and overtime and Kyrie's game and all of that. Learned that Kyrie doesn't need food or liquid while he's playing at such a high level. You know, what he was doing through Ramadan was just...
it was unbelievable.
I mean, it's just hard to even, like, you know, like, understand how he can play at that level and do what he's doing. So, yeah, I think they're the hottest team in basketball right now. I mean, we were joking the other day, like, it's such a weird feeling turning on some of these, like, national podcasts and basketball stuff that I listen to a lot, and so many of them are starting with Dallas. And it's like, hottest team in the league? Contenders? Where are they? And it's like all this stuff because the league is kind of taking notice right now that nobody wants to play the Mavericks.
Austyn, 5 wins in 7 days. They're able to grind through all this stuff while they're battered and bruised and beaten down and tired. And after all this travel, like, how are they able to do this?
I mean, yeah, Isaac said it. It's kind of the focus, the effort, but it's just really showing that they are ready for the playoffs. They recognize that something bigger and more important is coming up. And yes, all these individual games are important, but they're mentally preparing for, like, the task at hand of what their whole season, what you play for all season, is to get to the playoffs and get ready to play postseason basketball. And so, I mean, we've seen it since All-Star break. They win, or postseason trade, the trade deadline, they win 5 games in a row, or they go on the road and win 4 out of 5. And we're like, okay, they're hot. It's another streak. It's another winning streak. But it just continues. So it's showing that they're not just hot. This is how they are now. This is the Mavs. This is what this team is about. And so now they continue that. They are still the hottest team. They are still playing great defense as well. And it's just the perfect time that all of it is coming together because postseason basketball is about to be here.
And that was, you know, the Heat game, I think, is one of those, like, that was a prime opportunity for them to just kind of, like, coast it out.
Yeah.
Like, second night of a back-to-back, you're in Miami, you're kind of...
you've already got the X.
Yeah, you've already clinched your spot in the playoffs.
Tread lightly.
Secured. And
dunk on me, yeah. But hey, whenever it's time to dunk on you, you can't handle the Heat. It's like a real poster.
God bless. Anyway, they could have just taken that game off. And, you know, you texted me in the first quarter, like, what's going on?
They're up like 20, and I'm like, what is happening? What is this?
But, like, that, I think, is just a prime example of, like, where this team is at right now, that everyone would have understood if that game came out and they were flat and they were like, all right, like, arresting people or all of that for the playoffs. And they kind of came out and they're like, no, we don't care about this. Like, we want to win this game.
It's tough for people like us because, like, we're kind of on the inside. We're really on the outside. We're not part of this team. It's kind of hard to ascribe too much meaning to wins, right, to individual games, because we don't really know what's happening, right? But when the Mavs are able to, in succession, like, keep the Warriors at bay in the 9-10 play-in, you know, whenever they beat them, end the Rockets season, destroy Miami on their home floor on the second night of back-to-back on national TV, basically forcing the Heat into the play-in. Like, these are, you're going up against desperate teams that have a lot to play for, and the Mavs are able to just stiff-arm every single one of them. Like, that does mean something, right?
Yeah, I mean, it does. I mean, it's just they recognize, and it starts with your leaders. It starts with Coach K. It starts with Luka. It starts with Kyrie. Like, they are the ones that set the tone night in and night out. And if they come out and look focused and, you know, have that hunger in them and are telling their guys, like, we are winning this. It doesn't matter that we've traveled this much of a distance. It doesn't matter that we played last night. It doesn't matter who we're playing or who's not playing. Like, we are going to play our best. We're going to play defense and we're going to win. Like, when those guys, when your leaders are saying that, everyone else is going to follow behind. And that's exactly what we've seen. So, I mean, you got to give credit to the guys up top, but then everyone else is also playing their part and following along. And it's just the whole team just is really meshing right now. And it's just, it would be, I'm sure it's fun in the locker room. It's fun for all those guys, just the way they're playing right now. They're relaxed and they're just having fun.
Talking about setting the tone, in the first quarter against Miami, Dallas had 33 points. Luka and Kyrie combined for 23 of those points. So those guys come out, everyone's got to follow suit.
Yep.
You know, absolutely. Okay, so that's your little 5-game and 7-day stretch. But the Mavs have played 80 of these bad boys this season and been a very, very up and down season that's kind of hard to make too much sense of because so many guys are out. They totally reinvented the whole thing at the trade deadline. So there's a lot of like segments of this season. Right. But as we try to take a big picture look at what we've seen over the last 5-6 months, we can call some things that we were right about. You know, we did see some of this coming. We also did not see some of this coming. So let's talk about what we were right about and what we got wrong. Do we really know ball? Austyn, what is something that you got right about the Mavs this season?
Big picture approach, I'll say offense. Like, we knew coming into this season we had Luka, and we knew coming into the season we had Kyrie. We didn't see a ton of them together last year, but regardless, you have two elite prime offensive scorers, ball handlers. Like, they can go one-on-one, they can create for others. So it didn't matter what pieces were around them. We didn't know who was going to start at center. We didn't know who were going to, the wings were going to be as starters, but we knew we had Luka, we knew we had Kyrie, and with that, I knew that their offense was going to be at the top. It could compete with anyone a night in, night out basis. It could score 100 plus any game they need to in every game. So that's kind of a big picture, but I mean, I didn't have any worries about the offensive side of the floor for the Dallas Mavericks.
There was a lot of national concern about could they make it work. But Isaac, it also seemed like you were always pushing back against that too.
Yeah, you know, they were 5-11 together to end last season and felt like everybody was throwing that out there. And there's so many takes being thrown out. They can't work together. Luka can't play with Kyrie and all this. And it's like, dude, like, can we just give it a little bit more time? And, you know, we've referenced it a few times this season, but, you know, it was post-game during one of these big stretches for the Mavericks in the second half of the season. And Kyrie just kind of like laughs in the press conference afterwards, a post-game, because he's asked about playing with Luka, and he just like chuckles, and he's like, yeah, it's almost like we're, you know, we can play together. And, you know, kind of a, you know, jab there of like, yeah, like give us time healthy together, and we're good basketball players. And that's why, you know, they're too smart, they're too intelligent of basketball players to just not work. Like, they're gonna, like, these shots are just incredible if you're watching on YouTube right now of, you know, that game the other night when they're just walking arms around each other, it's like pulling at the heartstrings.
Dude, it was the most wholesome thing. It played on the Jumbotron in the arena too. Like, you could hear the crowd being like, ah, like it was just the coolest.
And, you know, you look at them this season, you know, they've played 1297 minutes together, and they have almost a plus 10 net rating. You know, their segments going on national TV right now, like, are they the most talented backcourt to ever play together? And it's like, man, this is a 12-month turnaround here.
Yeah.
So, we were all confident that they would work together and it would work out.
Well, of course we were. Yeah. Right?
State media.
Yeah.
But just to see at this level, seeing, you know, Kyrie healthy right now, seeing how they work off each other and compliment each other, a lot of stuff, you know, Austyn was saying, it just, yeah, I mean.
You also need to take another victory lap, Isaac, because you purchased a lot of real estate. You purchased a whole island in the offseason, pumping up a guy that the Mavs signed this summer.
Oh, Dante Exum. Yeah. You know.
Are you a billionaire at this point?
No. I mean, I didn't think he was going to have this much, this big of a role. I was a believer in him and some of the stuff, just the changes and his three-point shot, over the past 2 years. And I just loved the chance that they took on him and just bringing him in. You know, it was a cheap contract too, but it's kind of like the second chance in the NBA and what they need and want, at that spot of just his size. And, if the three-point shot's going down, then you have a guy that out there that can guard, one through four positions at times, and he can be a third ball handler. We're going to see Dante Exum probably close some playoff games. And that's just wild to think about. Just where his career has, him hitting the shot against Houston was just so much fun. And so I'm happy for him, happy for the Mavs too. And yeah, but it's still, I don't want to claim too much of a victory lap, but it's because it's gone too much.
You were early on the IPO. That's all that matters.
I really liked it. I didn't think it was going to go this well.
You don't need to take too much credit. You just cash out. All right. Just cash out. Count them up. Now we're going to have some one word reviews for most of the Mavs' top players and some of the other key figures in this whole thing here soon. But first, we can talk about some of the things we got wrong. Because we were right about a lot of the big stuff, but we weren't right about everything. Austyn, what's one thing that you were wrong about this season, for better or worse?
Well, I said offense I wasn't worried about. The defense I was. So that's kind of the thing that I will say I was wrong about. I didn't think...
You were right about it for most of the season.
Well, yeah, that's what I was going to say. So it started out, but how we finished, I could never picture that this is how the Mavs would be finishing this season as one of the best defensive teams at the top in so many different statistical categories of how they're playing defense, what Luka's doing on the defensive end. I didn't picture that. I didn't see that. I thought there were some issues. And even with, Grant Williams, I thought he would be probably the best defender and he's not even on the team anymore. So, there was definitely some question marks and I just didn't have a ton of faith in the defense of the Mavs. But you just have to give them so much credit for what they did, bringing in Gafford and Washington and what they've added to this team, what they've provided on the defensive end and completely changed the look of what the Mavs look like when they play defense. So, I'm happy I'm wrong. Yeah. I'll say that.
It's a good thing to be wrong about.
Yeah.
Gafford, Washington, Lively, Exum, Maxey, especially down the stretch, has been super good. Now, I don't want to give Luka and Kyrie too much credit because their plate is much less full on defense than it is on offense, but it is impossible for the Mavs to be the number one defense of the league without those guys being super locked in the way that they have.
Right. Yeah. I mean, they're not maybe guarding the best offensive player on a nightly basis, but they still have to guard. They still have to help. They still have to rebound. They still have to do all those other things. So, yes, Washington's probably getting the toughest defensive assignment, or Gafford's getting, a big guy inside that he's...
Derrick Jones. I forgot him. Derrick Jones. I'd be remiss.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, it's Luka and Kyrie are doing their part, but we have these other pieces now that have really stepped up and being those leaders and anchors on the defensive side of the floor.
I think it's really important for Luka, too, to see, maybe last season or earlier this season, sure, if I lock in, maybe we could be like 22nd on defense. Like, that's not worth it. But now, with the personnel they have around him, if he locks in on defense, they could be number one.
Yeah.
Like, if that's not motivation to get down in a stance, then...
Yeah, like, you see a little bit of a success and you're like, okay, yeah, like, maybe I'll play better defense or I'll focus a little bit more, but it still doesn't make that big of a difference as... big picture. When you think that, you're like, maybe every other possession I'll play harder defense. But when you see like you can be one of the best defensive teams, like that is way more incentive to truly focus on your defense, like on a night in, night out basis, on a possession to possession basis. And they've seen that and they've recognized that.
And they've won a lot because of it.
Yeah.
Isaac, we don't all shoot 100%.
Oh, heck no.
Show me some of your bricks this season.
All right. So I have two players. One that I thought would be better. The other one that I thought would take more time. One, I thought Grant Williams is going to have an incredible season in Dallas this year. I just thought for a lot of different reasons. And for a lot of different reasons, it didn't work out.
Yeah.
And now he's on the Hornets, enjoying playing with the Hornets. Tough season, though, in Charlotte.
I think Grant's fit with Luka. I want to say I got into a little bit yesterday. So every Wednesday, you and I stream. Mm-hmm. And every Thursday, I stream just solo in the basement. And somebody asked about Grant yesterday, and I said, I really think the reason it didn't work out is because, like, Grant and Luka have similar strengths, and they're, like, literally their strength and their sturdiness, but they have similar weaknesses in, like, foot speed. And I feel like what we've seen with Jones and Washington and even, like, you know, Maxey and Lively is that these guys, these bigger guys, are able to switch off and guard smaller, quicker players in ways that Grant wasn't able to. And so whenever it was the Kyrie, Luka, Grant trio, that's three guys you don't really want switching all that much.
Yeah.
And so it really kind of constrained them a little bit too much on defense. So I don't really think it's like Grant's deficiencies are the reason it didn't work. I just feel like the fit just wasn't totally, it just wasn't what we thought.
Yeah. And now he'll have an early offseason. So
don't dunk on the guy.
No, I was saying, like, I mean,
ouch.
You also played him in chess.
I did, and I beat him, luckily.
So you dunked on him. Like,
well,
you beat him.
It was a really close game. It came down to the end game.
Yeah.
It was fun, though.
So I was wrong on Dereck Lively in the sense of, you know, you look at historically, got, you know, young big guys who just take a little bit longer, or coaches on really good teams or playoff teams just don't play them. Like, they're just not in the rotation. So that's why even going into the draft – like, I was hearing stuff about Lively. I obviously watched him at Duke. But it was like, dude, I know the Mavericks, they're going for it this year. Like, they're going for the playoffs. Are they really going to play a rookie big man? Like, and are they really going to start him? Like, if you take a guy that high, like, you kind of he needs to be a starter at some point. And just to see, so I was kind of like, not out on him as a player, but more out on the fit as far as like what, I'm like, dude, they just kind of like need something that's going to be in the rotation. And just how well he's played. I mean, one game he started off the season, and then he's a starter, and he's been the starter. And obviously, they trade for Gafford and all that. And now it's just 1-2 punch. That's incredible. But I mean, I've been more like happy to be wrong about anything than him, his impact on a team that's, you know, really good. So once again, it had nothing to do with him as a player. It was just, man, they've just made it work, and he's going to play in the playoffs a lot of minutes.
Yeah, one of the biggest fears about rookie big men is not only like speed of the game and understanding coverages and offenses and whatever, it's just literally just fouls.
Yeah.
We're like, can you really afford to start this guy and then expose him to committing multiple fouls in the first 3 minutes? And it did happen at the beginning of the year. He did struggle with fouls.
Yeah.
And then he just stopped struggling with fouls. Like, he just figured it out. You know, it's very, very, very impressive. Austyn, did you see him coming?
No.
Because I thought it was going to be Omax playing and Lively maybe developing.
Yeah.
The tables have been kind of turned.
Yeah, no, I didn't anticipate him to come in and start by game two and be that role that he has had, that anchor, that voice. He's just so much older than what his age really is. He's so mature for being a rookie. And I think that's the biggest difference of why he made an impact this year in his first year, is because you can see that maturity. You can see just that basketball IQ, that knowledge. He's got a lot of advice and has people helping him and in his corner. But you have to give credit to him because he's the one that's doing it out on the court. And so, he's been a great surprise. He's been hurt. We haven't seen him a lot lately, but I think he's key. And when we've seen how when we had Gafford and him going back and forth, like having a post presence like that in the game at all times, like it makes the Mavs a really dangerous team. So he's vital for this team. But no, at the beginning of the season when we first drafted him, no, I didn't expect it to go like this.
Yeah, I just thought it was going to be a long-term
thing.
You know, I mean, he didn't even play the full season at Duke. Like,
right.
And his production wasn't even remotely close to what he's done in the NBA. Like, I think that it's perfectly normal to be wrong about Lively. And again, I'm happy to be wrong, just like you're happy to be wrong about defense.
Yep.
Isaac, I think you and I were in lockstep on that coming into the year. I mean, remember we were talking about, like, is it going to be Dwight or Rashawn Holmes as your starting five? We didn't even consider Lively really part of the equation at all. But I mean, hey, credit to him and credit to the Mavs coaching staff, you know, and all of a sudden now, you know, Grant was, I think, 24 or 25. Of course, they trade him for P.J. Washington, who's also, I think, 25, maybe. Daniel Gafford, 25. All of a sudden, the Mavs are like, they're pretty young. You know, they're actually a young team. It's like, it's not a joke anymore to call them a young team. Like, they legitimately are, for the most part, a young team. I woke up one day and realized that there's only one player on the team that's older than me. And that was, was kind of humbling.
Markieff?
Yeah, Markieff. And I think he's only older than me by like a few months. So it's It's getting close.
Wow.
It's getting close. There are some teams where I'd be the oldest player.
You're getting to the coaching staff age.
Oh, no. God, what a burn.
Austyn, he was struggling in the moment, and you just like.
I just really hammered it in. Yeah, I know.
Went for the kill. Wow.
Jeez, I'm getting to the coaching age.
Hey, more knowledge.
Now that said,
more knowledge.
If any coaches, if any coaches out there are looking for assistance this summer, hit me up. Yeah. I am of age
you
now.
You could have said like GM age or like.
Yeah, no, just coach. Yeah. Owner age. I do wear a lot of quarter zips, so I already
You'd
have the
in.
Look down.
Yep.
Yeah, I do have the look down. Yeah, polos, a lot yeah. of polo. I'm a big polo guy. I do wear a lot of basketball shorts and sweatpants when I'm at home. So I'm like.
You're ready.
95% of the way there.
You were there, yeah.
All I need to do is learn about basketball. That's just like, that's the one missing piece.
Do you have a polo section in your closet?
I have a polo section in my, what do you call it? Is it like an armoire? Or like a big old dresser?
The crap did you just say?
Is that a thing? Armoire?
Armoire. You're so
sure.
bougie.
Like I said, I'm a coach.
Do you fold your polos or hang them?
I think, no, it's not an armoire. What I have is just a dresser. I fold them.
A dresser? That was the word you were looking
like,
for?
What's a big... It's like a big old thing. It's like a big thing.
With drawers?
Yeah, but it's like a little more elaborate than that. I don't know. Oh. Maybe I'll bring a picture.
A vanity?
I don't know what that means. That's
I feel like
not
that's
even
where girls
do
makeup.
Do you fold your polos or hang your polos?
I'm a folder.
You're okay. a folder.
Yeah, I'm a folder, yeah.
All right.
I used to be a hanger, but it's like that's just way too
much. One word to describe yeah. Bobby. Folder.
Yeah, folder. Okay. So we're now going to do a little rapid fire section here. This is season in review for, I chose 8 players on the Mavs and 1 non-player on the Mavs. You'll just have to guess who that could be.
Oh.
We'll build up excitement for that one till the end.
Same age as Bobby.
The Mavs dog.
Yeah.
Mavs man.
Bailey.
Bailey. Yeah. Bailey. Great. Just 14 out of 10.
Lovable.
Yeah.
Cuddly.
Fluffy. Like Fluffy. Moon milk.
Oh, my God.
All right, so I want you to give me a one-word recap, okay, of this player's season or impact on the team or however you want to view it, and then also a little bit of justification. So it's not literally just one word. It's one word and then explain why.
Okay.
All right, let's start with maybe the easiest one or maybe the hardest one, Luka Doncic, Austyn.
Pravi. Which I didn't know what that word was until just the other day when we saw all the shirts, the coaching staff and players wearing that Pravi MVP shirt. I did have to Google what it meant, but it means like real in Slovenian. So Luka is not just the real MVP, but the real deal. He's legit. He's one of the best. And so, I mean, he is as real as it gets as a basketball player, as a scorer, as, you know, anything you can think of to describe Luka, he is real. He's legit. And so, Pravi.
Mm, going bilingual. I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
Isaac.
Yeah, I mean, I'll say magic. You know, the season that Luka's having, I feel like I need to make up a stat to improve his MVP case right now. Because that's what we do now.
He's kind of faltering in Raptor and LeBron and Darko. And
the kitchen sink.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, you know, he deserves to, you know, be MVP of the league, and just what he's done this year, he's doing the most. Like they, and you know, on top of that, the 73-point game, the one-handed like scoop shot finger roll from the 3-point line, just some of the stuff he's pulled off this season, yeah, magic.
And also, not just those, but like, how about the shot to beat Brooklyn in the home opener?
Yeah.
How about the shot to close the game against Miami? You know, that dude is magical. My word is unprecedented. We've never seen anything like Luka before, so nobody really knows what kind of sense to make of it. And I think eventually everyone will one day realize, oh my God, this guy is a one of one. And what were we missing for all those years whenever I was going on TV saying some dumb stuff? Luka's pretty good. I think we universally agree.
It's a good take.
How about Kyrie Irving, Isaac? One word to describe Kyrie's season.
All right, this is what I had the hardest with. I put return. Just because I feel like this season's been his return back to like who Kyrie is. And it's a reminder. Maybe it's a reminder of just how great he is, and that he's going to be a Hall of Famer, that he's won a title, that to see this, you know, these stretches of healthy Kyrie Irving, there's, you know, I think a lot of people's kind of forgotten how good he is over the past handful of years for a bunch of different reasons on and off the court, that we haven't got to see him for extended stretches play at this level. And now we're seeing it again, and everyone's being reminded, all right, this is one of the all-timers.
Austyn?
I'll say clutch for what we see him do in the fourth quarter on any game basis. Like, he can take over a game. He is going to score when the Mavs need it most. I'll also say consistent, because he has been...
One word.
Well, it's an option. Okay. They are both one words. I was just
that's
giving you
true.
Two one word.
That's true. You're bending the rules, but that's fine.
To have the chance to shoot 90, 50, 40 in a season, like, consistent is the only thing you can think of to do that. Like, you have to be very consistent every game you're playing to shoot at that high of a level. So those are both one word answers for Kyrie.
That's true. There's got to be a word that is synonymous with both clutch and consistent.
Like, combine them together.
Yeah. Yeah, but I can't think of it right now. Those are both good answers. Mine would just be like intangible. You can point to the stats, you can point to the clutch shots, mm-hmm. you can point to what he's done before and kind of the what happened in the few years before he did make his return. Like, those are both very valid things, but so much of what he does can't really be quantified. You could also say words like impact, you know,
leadership,
like. There's this air of confidence that he brings. There's this air of, like, community that he brings. There's just all these things that you're like, I don't really know what it is that I'm seeing, but I know that I wasn't seeing it before he was here, you know? And he just has this, like, je ne sais quoi, you know, to make it trilingual now.
Yep. There you go.
All right. Derrick Jones Jr. Isaac, I challenge you to speak in a fourth language. Can you do that?
I can't, no.
Is there a Brazilian word for Derrick Jones Jr.? Or I guess that would be Portuguese. I need to log off so bad.
All right. just international Bobby.
I'm trying so hard.
I put outperformed.
Okay.
And outperformed his contract, outperformed what a lot of people... thought, including myself. Like, I was so high on Omax going into this season, and I was kind of like in the camp, like, I don't like, what is Derrick Jones Jr.? Is he just like a roster filler, or is he going to be in the rotation? Well, I mean, you look at his past seasons compared to his minutes, you know, played this year, how many games he started, and now he's like, I mean, he's a key part of this rotation, a starter. He's locked in this, you know, this spot as a starter. And I feel like he's outperformed everything that you would want in signing a minimum contract veteran, you know, to your roster.
I would have never imagined he would be anywhere near the top in minutes played. Yeah. And yet here we are. Austyn, how about you?
Yeah. So I'll say versatile, because he can do different things. He can kind of mold into what you need him to do. He's a go with the flow type of guy. So coming off the bench or now starting, and he's, you know, can switch on defense. He can knock down shots on offense. So he can kind of just do a little bit of everything, kind of just like fits in wherever you need him to, and kind of shift and, you know, form into what you need him to for that game or for that possession or whatever it may be. So I'll just say he's versatile.
I think I would say indispensable. Like, he's kind of the only guy on the team that can do everything that he does.
Mm-hmm.
There are guys that can dunk. There are guys that can run the floor. There are guys that shoot. There are guys that can defend. There are guys that can defend guards, but none of them can do all those things. Like, it is really hard to imagine what this whole deal would look like, especially defensively, without him.
Yeah.
Also, did you say versatile? Are you a versatile sayer?
What is it?
Like, versatile?
Versatile. 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 I don't know.
What do you say?
Versatile.
Versatile. How do you say the word the word that precedes golf, like putt-putt golf? How do you say the word that starts with M?
Mini? Mini putt-putt?
The full word.
Miniature?
You say miniature? Okay, so I say miniature.
What?
No, that one's for sure wrong.
I say miniature, yeah.
There's no debate on that one. That one's for sure wrong.
Yeah, it's just miniature.
I don't know. I say miniature. I feel like versatile is the I feel like versatile is like the more proper way to say it, but I'd say the cheap one, versatile. So I'm surprised that you take the shortcut on miniature.
Not a shortcut. That's just
I don't know. Drop a comment. Let us know.
You also don't call your dresser a dresser.
And I call it an armoire.
Yeah.
All right, moving on. PJ Washington. Austyn, we've only seen him for about 2 months, but man, he's made an impact.
Yeah, I'll say hungry for him. Like, he's come in, was hungry to play on a team like the Dallas Mavericks, who are playing for something, who were striving to get to the playoffs, and not just get to the playoffs, but make a deep push. And he hasn't been around that before. So he was eager for this opportunity. He's focused, and he's come in every night and just shown that hunger with the way that he's focused and he plays, and the way that he's fit in with this team.
Yeah, I said evolution. Just that, and this one, it's kind of tough for me because he's kind of just evolved into this key part of a winning team that we've seen. He's one of the, you know, one of these examples of when you look around the league and you have these struggling teams and these guys that are putting up good numbers and they're, you know, one of the best players on these, on the struggling teams, and you kind of wonder, I wonder if they could kind of evolve their game to play, or like evolve their, just take a step up in the career to play a certain role. You know, a prime example of that is Aaron Gordon, of having, you know, that first part of his career in Orlando. And I mean, they just, all the different positions he played and number one option at time, like all this stuff. And then he gets traded to Denver and he has this defined role and he's playing within a system and they've won a title. They could win another title. So I think evolution's where I landed on him. Now we're seeing him really excel in this role.
I'm going to say oasis. Oh. Because because for as I think as hungry as PJ is to prove himself, right, I think the Mavs have been thirsting for a guy like him for a really, really long time. Like, they had, okay, they had Dorian, and Dorian had the height and the length, but maybe he didn't have, like, the strength and the bulk. Then they had a guy like Grant that had the bulk, but maybe he didn't have, like, the quickness. Then you get PJ, who kind of has the best of both worlds. You know, he's probably the biggest, like, the biggest power forward-ish sort of guy that the Mavs have had in the Luka era, unless you count Dirk in that, because Dirk was very big, but he's not quite like PJ on defense. But he possesses the offensive skills too that are like that both fit within the system, but that add something new to it. The ability to put the ball on the floor, finish floaters, back guys down, finish around the rim, run the floor. You know, it is a new thing here. Like, he represents a lot of qualities that we have not seen around here that I feel like he's taking advantage of the opportunity, but also the Mavs have just desperately needed a guy like him forever. These big wings, man, I've been pounding the table. Get a big wing. Now they finally have one and it's great.
That's why you should be a coach.
Because I,
you know, you recognize,
because I know a lot of words.
Yeah,
I got a big lexicon.
Yeah,
hire me.
Thirsting.
Yeah, they were. It's like an oasis. It's a spot. Like, we need it so bad. Yeah. Okay, Big Dan, Gaff, the Gaffmeister, the landlord, Austyn. One word to describe the big man.
Well, I was going to say streaky, but streaky is not the right thing because he's not like up and down streaky. But the fact that he has had these long streaks of making so many shots, like streaky in a good way, I guess consistent. I mean,
streaking.
I said streaking. Yeah.
Streaker.
Yeah. Sure. I don't know if he does that, but yeah.
I don't know anybody that does that either.
Yeah, just...
Just keep going.
Yeah.
Just pretend I don't exist.
I will. Okay.
people do it all the time.
But for him to come in and play the defense that he has, to rebound, to defend, but what he's done on offense, the way he can pick and roll, and he's just making literally everything and shooting at such a high percentage, has been so impactful for the Mavs and the way that Luka plays off him and the way that we run this offense now. So for him to have these streaks of 30 plus, and now I think he's at 22, I think, so he's building up another streak. So streaking. I don't know, but yeah, consistent. I change it to consistent.
I love it.
All right, Isaac, can you top that?
No, I can't. I put maximized, like his strengths are just all maximized here. You know, I think of, you know, somebody like wherever you work, you might have had an employee that is a good employee, but then they like switch departments or they like there's a strength they have. And then it's like, oh, man, if we just put you in this role, then that strength would you would just really excel. And now we're seeing all the stuff he's really strong at is exactly what Dallas needs. And we're seeing him at this, like, it's just all of his strengths, the, you know, lob, you know, the dunking, rebounding, defense. These are things that he excels at, and they're just being ultimately maximized here in Dallas.
Yeah, I think the word is the word that I was thinking of is like validation, you know, because I know like a lot of Mavs fans have felt, okay, well, not a lot of Mavs fans actually felt this way, but let me get to the point. Dwight Powell, pick and roll, awesome partner with Luka. A lot of Mavs fans want that, but better, right? So if only Dwight could be a little taller, if only he could be a little stronger, if only he could be better on defense, like then what could happen? And you see Daniel Gafford from afar, and it was like, man, Daniel Gafford, like he kind of is like that, but you know, bigger. And now he's here, and it's like, yeah, Daniel Gafford definitely is like that. Yeah. You know, and this is no slight to Dwight, but Dwight is a little older now. Like 25-year-old Dwight could do some of the stuff that Gafford can, but Gafford is like, dude, he's just been so good. And you know, we've known watching Luka play with Mike Toby, you know, on the Slovenia national team, watching him play in Real Madrid with all their rim runners. Like Luka likes having these lob targets. He likes knowing that his big man is going to be at the rim whenever he needs him to be. And so I thought it would just be such a perfect fit with a guy like Gafford. I mean, me and Mike have just been oasising after this guy forever. You know, we've loved him. And so I just feel like everybody feels validated. Like fans do. We do. Luka does. Gafford does, because Gafford probably knew, hey, all along, like, I can be a good player on a good team. Guys, just get me out of here, you know. And so I feel like it's just a win-win-win-win-win-win-win for everybody. Like, we're all just happy about this. There's no streaking. We're consistently happy. Like, there might be if the Mavs win the title, if they go on another streak in the playoffs.
Except for teams who didn't trade for Gafford.
Except for the teams that didn't trade for
Gafford. I bet there legitimately are a few teams out there that had trade talks that needed another big that we're probably going to see come playoff time that they're like, man, if that team just had another big, that they're like, dang, we should have traded for him.
Yeah.
And they didn't. So
and good. For PJ, too, for both those guys.
Yeah.
He's like, there weren't many sellers at the trade deadline, but the Mavs made trades, the two of them.
Yep.
And guess what? It worked. Okay. Let's go to a guy that you were wrong about, Isaac. Dereck Lively II.
Yeah, I don't have to say much. I mean, I said surprising. So just surprising as a rookie. He's going to be an all-rookie. He should be on one of the all-rookie teams. We walked through those teams on Wednesday in the live stream. He surprised me. I think he surprised a lot of people just how, you know, well he's played this season.
I'll go really basic. He's lively.
Ooh, okay. All right, okay.
With the way that he's played, you don't like that? Too cheesy?
That's pretty cheesy.
Yeah, I know.
I thought it was a good one.
I know. Okay, well, yeah, it's cheesy. But just his youthfulness, his energetic, the way that, you know, he's bouncy, just coming in eager to play in the NBA, and he's played with that liveliness all season. So, sorry for my cheating.
exuberance. Dude, he's young, and he plays with a lot of energy, and that just has, you know, especially coming out of last season, right, when at the end of the year, it was like, man, I don't think anybody, like, wants to spend 1 second longer on the court than they have to. I think everyone's ready to just get this season over with, you know? On opening night, the Spurs jump out to a big lead, and the Wimby hype is real, and everything is like, is this going to happen again? Like, is this team not going to defend again? Are we going to lose this game again? Like, is this going to be a repeat of last season? Obviously, game one of 82 is like, you're looking way too far into the first quarter of a first game, and then Lively comes in and is just a maniac on the boards, and it gets a double-double, and maybe arguably outplays Wimby that night, and you're like, oh my God, this guy can, like, whoa. And he's just a spark plug, and he's able to maintain that for 30 minutes if you need him to. Like, it's just really cool to have a lot of young players, a lot of juice. You know, he brings the juice. Gaffman brings the juice, too. All of them do.
Not the moon milk.
Not the moon milk. We bring the moon milk here in Studio 41, presented by Chime.
Too fluffy.
Isaac, let's go to a player that you were right about, Dante Exum.
Capitalize. He's capitalizing on his second chance. Like, I mean, if you just put down a paper of, like, a guy who goes out of a league for 2 years and then gets a second chance, this is how you capitalize on that chance and on that moment. And he's been I almost put reliable, because he's been so reliable when he's on the floor that and it would be wrong. It's like, I almost want to say, like, he's not, because he's not going to do, like, the flashy plays, but he actually does do flashy plays.
Yeah.
But he's just reliable. He's capitalizing on his second chance and his moment back in the league. And hopefully he's in the league for Yeah, good long time.
Yeah, kind of the same thing. Redemption, like he's getting that second chance. So he's made the most of it, and yeah, kind of exactly what you said. But redemption.
What a year for him too, becoming a dad. He's taking opportunity of a second chance, and just past 12 months have been pretty good for X.
Yeah, great for him. Austyn, I'm going to steal one of the two words that you use for Kyrie. I'm going to say clutch. In the fourth quarter, he's been money.
Yeah.
I mean, he hit the biggest shot of the game against the Kings to kind of close that one out in the second game when the Mavs made the comeback win. He hit the buzzer beater to force overtime against Houston whenever they capped off a big comeback and ended up winning the game. In the fourth quarter this year, I think he's above 60% from three. I think he's around 50% from three for the season. Like, the dude has just been money. And clutch in the sense that when Kyrie was out for a month or two in December, Dante was able to help keep the team afloat. I mean, Luka went to levels we haven't seen before, obviously, but, like, Dante Exum was amazing, too. You know, every time he's had to step up, he's delivered. So, hey, shout out to Dante Exum. But you can make the case. I think that's the great thing about this team. Obviously, we know Luka and Kyrie are, like, the guys, right? But you could make the case for every single one of the guys that we've talked about already. Where would this team be if this guy wasn't doing what he's doing? You know, I think that's the sign of a real team.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. Okay, last player before we get to our surprise one at the end. Austyn, Tim Hardaway Jr. Can you give me one word for Timmy?
I'll say what his role is like he's that spark.
We've been visited by ducks, but now we just got visited by a ghost. There was a
Tim was coming in.
He accepted the role of being the sixth man this year, and that role you want to come in off the bench and provide an instant spark. You want to pick up the energy, come in and make an impact, do something if you know your team is struggling or something's not going right. You are the guy, the sixth man that comes in and tries to fix that, tries to do something to make an impact. So his role of hopefully every time he comes in providing some type of spark. I think down the stretch he's been a lot smarter with his shot selection, but he knocks down shots and that provides a spark when he does that.
Yeah, I put confused. I think it's been hard. It's been a harder season for him because, you know, the role, he struggled at times with his shot, and where does he fit in with Kyrie and Luka playing at such a high level? Then, you know, if he is for sure coming off the bench, then he's, you know, who's he playing with then? They've had a lot of, you know, injuries, people missing time, not a ton of, you know, lineup stability to where, you know, you can look at it like a Denver, OKC, some of these teams at the top of the West, and they've played 700-800 minutes together, you know, their five-man units and stuff. I think it's just been kind of a confusing season for Tim to figure out, like, where he fits in and what his, like, exact role is, especially whenever his shot's not falling, he's going through those, like, slumps and stuff. So,
confused. I think your word spark is really good, Austyn. So
you like mine better than yours.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, I think that's – I maybe even like
this is the teacher each
yeah,
time.
I'm like, well, he picked mine.
The score is 4-4 right now. I would almost use the word essential. Now, I'm not going to sit here and tell you that Tim has had like the best season of his career or anything. He slumped for a couple months. Like, he just could not get shots to fall. And, you know, as the team's identity has shifted more toward defense, his role has kind of diminished a little bit. But here's the deal, you know. It's very easy at the end of the season to look back and say, man, those two losses against the Grizzlies sure do hurt right now. If they would have won those games, the Mavs would be fourth. It's also very easy to say, man, that win against the Knicks, without that, Dallas might be in the play-in right now. You know, and in that win against the Knicks with no Luka, Tim had 32. How about the win against the Pelicans after a hugely disappointing loss, again, without Luka? Tim had 41. How about the big comeback win against the Magic? Tim had 36. How about the Dante game against the Lakers? Tim had 32. Kyrie did not play in that game, if memory serves, I'm pretty sure. Tim's offensive outbursts in a lot of close games, by the way.
That Warriors game, some of those clutch rebound.
Yeah, for sure. DJ, yeah. But, like, 32 points in a game where they won by four. 32 in a game they won by two. 36 in a game they won by two. 41 in a game they won by five. I think all four of those games were without either Luka or Kyrie. Yeah, sometimes he has rough games. But this season, when he scores 10 or more points, The Mavs are 35-20. When he scores 15 or more points, the Mavs are 25-12. When he scores 20, they're 12-5. When he scores 30, they're 5-1. So his slumps hurt really bad. But when he's on, especially in the games when Luka or Kyrie or both are out at times throughout his tenure here, or Jalen are out or KP's out, like at any point, really, in the Tim experience, he is the only guy that they've had that you can kind of count on to take 20 shots, you know, and to score 30 points or whatever. So, you know, there was a 2-month stretch where it was like, man, brutal. But the first 2 months of the season, when Kyrie's out a whole lot, like, we can say the same thing. Where would they be if Tim hadn't gotten off to that really hot start, you know? And it feels like the last few games he is kind of like, I think he's sort of out of the slump now. Yeah. He's had a couple stinkers, but for the most part, like, he's been stepping up a lot lately.
It's just a lot easier to remember the bad things, but, like, yeah, you have to remember all the good times, the crucial shots, the big games. So, yeah, for Mavs fans, it's easier to remember that one time that he missed how many shots in a game or whatever, had that slump. But
yeah, because, I mean, he went, whatever, 1-for-7 in a game they lost by 2.
Right.
Just like he scored 32 in a game they won by 2. So, you know, giveth and taketh. But, like, again, for a really long time, he's been the only player on the team that can give you 20 outside of Kyrie and Luka. You know, now they have Gafford's giving you a little bit. Mm-hmm. PJ's gone off. So, like, they have more options now. But it wasn't always the case.
Yeah.
It wasn't always the case. And, you know, we're going to take a little sneak peek at Mavs Clippers here in a second. But obviously, everything that you are going to do in the postseason starts with Luka and Kyrie. And it really ends with Luka and Kyrie. But if the Mavs are going to do anything in the playoffs, they will need Derrick Jones, PJ Washington, Daniel Gafford, Dereck Lively, Dante Exum, Tim. They'll need all of those guys to have good games. Or good series, like prolonged stretches of good basketball. Every single one of them is essential. Two guys we didn't mention, Josh Green, Maxi Kleba, both missed a lot of games this season, but they will factor a whole lot in to the next round potentially. So we'll get to them in a second as well. But the last one, non-player division. How about Jason Kidd? Give me one word to describe Jason Kidd, Isaac.
Flat bill hat.
That's two words, but I'll take it.
Now, I'll say connector. You know, arguably Jason Kidd's biggest strength is his ability to connect with teammates, connect with stars, connect, you know, the guys to each other and the coaching staff, just all the stuff. Like, he is he was a connector when he played in the league. It's a testament whenever you see, you know, opposing teams come in and you see after a game, before the game, just how many players go to Jason Kidd. It's kind of like Kyrie in a way, but just how many players have so much respect for Jason Kidd. A lot of them grew up watching him play basketball too, so connector.
Yeah, he's the leader of the team, but I'll say, like, trust. Like, he has trust in the players and the team that the Mavs have, and the players have trust in him. He's like the final puzzle piece. Like, he's put together this puzzle with all these different players and pieces, but you still have to have that coach. You still have to have that final puzzle piece to, like, complete the puzzle. So without him, without the coach, the leader of this team, like, the puzzle's not complete. So, but trust.
Trust is one of the two words that they have written on their film room wall alongside chemistry. Chemistry,
yeah,
that starts with the players. Trust, that's kind of stems from the coach. The coach has trust in the players. The players have trust in each other. Without that trust coming from the coach, and without the trust going upward toward the coach,
mm-hmm.
you can't really have that. And that ability to connect is super important, Isaac, too. The word that I was going to use, I don't think is a word, but empowerer, is that a word? Someone who bestows empowerment upon other people. Yeah. Everyone's least favorite thing about, not everybody, but a lot of people's least favorite thing about Kidd is that he doesn't really call timeouts. But this is like a two, three, four-year project to, like, hey, absorb the blow and bounce back, figure it out. And now, like, how many times do the Mavs opponents go on like a 10-0 run? Like, it just doesn't really happen much anymore. Like, they're able to stay steady. Like, that's the whole point. The players are communicating. The coach doesn't have to say, hey, guys, let's try harder. The players do that now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, that is the whole point. Like, J. Kidd has empowered Kyrie. He's empowered Luka to say things. He's empowered Markieff Morris to say things. Empowered Tim to say things. The players are, like, huddling. It almost looks like a college basketball game sometimes. The players are, like, huddling up after a foul to, like, talk about stuff. Like, they're working out the problems themselves. And that is, you know, just like a very authoritative coach sitting everybody down and saying, you do this, you do this, you do this, let's go, team on three, like a Tom Tibbs type, you know, Tom Thibodeau. So too can the empowering silent coach who's like, hey, you guys figure it out. And if you do, we'll win. And if not, then I'll say something. Like, and J-Kid has taken that route and didn't always work last season. It hasn't always worked this season, but it sure has worked for the last 2 months to levels we haven't seen around here in a really, really long time. So, okay, that is a little one-word recap. Now let's take a look as J-Kid and the Mavs prepare for part three. Now we're going to have a thorough Mavs-Clippers preview coming up next week. But as we take a look at the Western Conference standings, hey, we woke up the other day and realized we got another one. We got another one. Mavs-Clippers part three. In some order, Dallas and LA will be that 4-5 out west. With Denver's win against Minnesota the other night, that game could have gone either way, and then Denver ended up winning by about 60. That was kind of a strange fourth quarter. Denver is in the driver's seat for the number one seed, so the Mavs and the Clippers are guaranteed to play. The winner of that series will likely take on Denver or the eight seed in round two. Mini and OKC will be grappling for the 2-3 for home court in the second round, and then New Orleans, with their win against the Kings last night, has the leg up on the Suns for the sixth seed. Now, good luck trying to figure out what's going to happen between 8 and 10. All those teams are tied. And
big names down there, though.
Big names. And the Suns play the Kings tonight. And so if the Kings win that game, then it gets even more jumbled. Like, it is a very, very precarious position for a lot of these big-name teams, 7 through 10. But, hey, Mavs Clippers. Potentially Nuggets in round two. It's going to be a tough path. It's going to be a dramatic path. How are we feeling? I guess, before we do a, because we're going to take a little quick preview of Mavs Clippers. But before we do that, do you feel vindicated about your take on the play-in? Because you like the play-in, right?
Yeah.
And this is pretty exciting if you're a play-in believer.
Yeah, that's why I'm like, it's like you said, the Lakers, the Warriors, the Suns, like they're all battling for the play-in right now. I mean, if you didn't have that, two of those teams aren't even...
They'd still be battling just for the eight seed.
Okay,
they'd be battling for more humiliation.
I just like the play-in. I do like it. I think it's good.
I'm going to text you every night the play-in's
now,
on.
Next,
hey, what do you think about this game?
Now next season when like the 9 and 10 seeds are like 10 games behind the 7 and 8, then yeah, I'm going to be like, okay, it's stupid this year, but...
Look at Miami, though, in the East.
It's not so much like the play-in concept you love. It's like this specific outcome is good.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Yeah. I can't like bend back and forth and decide like right before like the postseason starts if, oh, we should have the play-in this year because it's a tight race or not. I know you can't do that. But yeah, in cases like this and years like this, I do like it. So I'm kind of...
Isaac, I do have to admit... There being a play-in is kind of cool this year because the Mavs aren't a part of it. But
yeah, whatever.
I will take joy in the failures. I can't wait. I will be there no matter what.
I think this is kind of funny because, you know, obviously we're not, I don't, whatever. It's the Heat. The difference between the eighth and ninth spot in the East.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Six games. Like, yeah. That's a pretty, yeah.
Yeah, the difference between the eight and nine in the West is a tiebreaker. Yeah. Okay. So a little bit of Mavs-Clippers. Like I said, next week we're going to do a whole deep dive. We're going to go into every aspect of that matchup. But as we just saw in the standings, in some order, the Mavs and the Clippers will be playing in the 4-5. It's round three. Mavs are 0-2. I guess our little sneak peek of this is, why will this time be different, Austyn? Or why might this time? I don't want to guarantee a win or whatever.
The Mavs look completely different, even just from not just the past two times we played them in the first round, but from this season when we played them, all three games were before Christmas. We didn't have Gafford. We didn't have Washington. So this team is completely different. So the Mavs are more equipped now to play a team like the Clippers. The Clippers are kind of, they have veteran players, but they're a roller coaster. They're inconsistent, and the Mavs have been really consistent in the past couple months. So I think that's going to be the biggest difference. It's like the Mavs have shown that consistency lately, and the Clippers don't always show that.
Isaac, you sat here, I don't remember, was it 2 weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago, we talked about which team we don't want to play face.
Mm-hmm.
My answer was Denver, which if the Mavs win, they'll do that in round two. Your answer was the Clippers. So now that you've hopefully had a chance to get over the existential dread and sort of face, you know, face the music here, how are you feeling? Why could this year be different?
Yeah, I'm pretty confident in the Mavs going into this into the series, especially with how they're wrapping up the season. And, you know, the Clippers, they can, it's hard to like judge like where they're at because it's Kawhi, it's these guys, they've been there, done that. But I am confident. But I would also say that if, you know, whoever they matched up against besides Denver, I would probably be pretty confident too. And it's more about the Mavs than it is the opponent just because of how well they're playing. You know, how they're different this time, obviously, I mean, the past two times that they played in a playoffs, they didn't have Kyrie. And now you have, you know, Kyrie to go alongside Luka. It feels like they finally have some versatility. Is that how you say that?
If it's versatility.
Okay.
Interesting. Okay.
But versatile.
You know, they have guys that can switch. Some of the matchup stuff I'm fascinated by. Of just like how, you know, when do the teams go small? You know, the last time they played in the playoffs, that was when, you know, Boban was, you know, starting, getting a bunch of minutes. And how much does Zubats play, your twin? You know, Luka loves, you know, just...
He's like a foot taller than me.
Luka loves ISOing him out. So, like, how do the teams, like, shift? You know, if they matched up with any of the other teams above them, you know, you have a Chet, you have the two towers in Minnesota, you have Jokic, but they play this, you know, Clippers team that can go small, can, you know, kind of match Dallas in this way of, like, there's probably going to be stretches of this game, you know, of this series to where Maxie's at the five, we might see PJ at the five, and it's just like ultimate switch, small ball, fast-paced.
Fast is good, though, for this year's team.
Yeah,
a couple years ago,
yeah.
Faster the game, no thank you.
Yeah, I'm curious about what the rebounds look like in this series.
Are you?
I actually am, yeah. Okay. You look at the Clippers because they, you know, they allow a lot of offensive rebounds. And, you know, if Dallas does go, you know, stay big at times and keep Gafford in there lively, you know, we've seen Gafford pull down a ton of offensive rebounds. So will that be an area that Dallas really capitalizes on that? And, you know, those lead to second chance points. It was just the other day we were talking about second chance points, how much Dallas had in that game. So, yeah, I mean, a lot of this series depends on what Kawhi Leonard you're getting. He's been out for a long time with the knee stuff or a few weeks, so... If he's back fully healthy come playoffs, it's going to be fascinating. It's going to be a lot of fun to watch. But I'm actually, like, weirdly pretty confident in Dallas.
I'm mostly just excited, man. I'm just excited. I'm excited to see how it goes. You know, this team has played playoff intensity caliber games for the last, like, 2-3 weeks now. Every game has mattered so much for them, and so many games have mattered for their opponents as well. And now it's a reunion with my brother from you know him, you there love him from Croatia. Me and my Croatian twin, Ivica Zubac. I'll see you soon, Ivica. Hang on, let me look up.
There's a lot of returning players for the Clippers too from that series. More for the Clippers than Dallas, but like Terrence Mann, we've seen him and Luka have some moments, you know, together on the court. Obviously Kawhi and Paul George and, you know, Zubac. They don't have, you know, Batum and Marcus Morris and those guys. As I continue to chat about time for you. You got it?
Vidjet Chute Uskoro. It's Croatian for I will see you soon.
Wow. I wonder if they have a saying like that in Brazilian.
Okay. Sorry. I was excited to talk about another language and I misspoke. My bad. All right. He's relentless.
Yeah.
So
it's
all right.
You got it right in American.
That's the best language, baby. All right. We're going to get so much deeper into Mavs Clippers next week. We're going to have stats. We're going to have insight. We're going to have some predicties. We're going to maybe do a whole playoff bracket. How about that? That might be fun. Should we do that?
Don't forget, because you forgot March Madness.
That's true. I did.
Wow.
I have to take the L on that, but I will not take a single L in the playoff bracket. So come to you next week. We're going to have a big old preview.
Are we predicting, like, how many games and outcome of the series?
Yeah. The whole thing.
I already got mine.
You don't even know who's going to play each other. Or is it just Mavs 4-0, 4-0, 4-0, 4-0?
No, I got mine for like this series.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah. No, save it. All right, I'll save it for next week. Save it for next week. Mute his mic, Chopper, because he might mutter it, and I don't want anyone to you know, I don't want it to be spoiled for anybody.
I can't talk while the plane lands.
Yeah, that's right. You need to turn your phone off and sit down and shut up. All right.
Please buckle up for the landing.
That's right. Thank you, guys. We already came through and collected your trash. For Austyn and Isaac, I'm Bobby. Hey, for Kat and Chopper in the back, I'm also Bobby, and you are awesome. And we will see you for the season finale of the Corner 3 next week. Until then, take care, enjoy some Mavs basketball, and we'll see you.